I'm glad that you are here this morning. My name is Pastor Kennan. We are in the best, most relaxed space you can imagine. There is no expectation. We're here together. The only thing we're going to do is praise the Lord together and have a good discussion about our scripture. We're going to sing songs, family reunion style, and one thing that we gather around every single week is a testimonial video, and I'm very excited for you to hear today's testimony because it is, it's a blessing. You know, they always are, but this one is special. I want you to take a look.
So when I was young, I was raised Catholic, and it was good, learned a lot, but Catholic services always felt more ceremonial than a teaching. So it was like if, in my case, when I did go, it was Christmas and Easter, you kind of got the same out of it, no matter if you went Christmas and Easter or if you went the other 52 weeks of the year. Here, it's you actually get something. You know, there's more of a teaching aspect of it. There's more of a learning part of it. Probably more fellowship too than what I was used to. When I was a kid and we'd leave the church, it was always, we'd talk about where we're gonna go to lunch, but it was just the family. It was never outside people. It was always just like me, my grandparents, mom, we would go, but it was never anything with other people involved. And you know, I went through some stuff that was personal and stayed away for 2-3 months. And when I got back, when I decided to finally come back, it was like open arms. Like people I would have never thought would have even come talk to me were like, man, I'm genuinely glad to see me, and shaking your hand. And it was different. I was like, man, I'm not used to this. It's like some of the people, I was just like, I can't believe that just happened. It really made you feel welcome. And like in my line of work, I am going to customers every day, you know, 7 to 10 a day. And they're glad to see you, but they're glad to see you because you're there for a specific job that you're doing for them. And once you're done, it's not like they're your buddies or anything. It's like, okay, well, good seeing you. See you next week. And they kind of want you out their way. And it's no talking and hanging out. Some of them I've become friends with, and we talk for a few minutes and sometimes 30 minutes and end up getting behind, but it's worth it. But for the majority of it, there's no brotherhood out there. It's just, it is definitely transactional. It's definitely, don't waste my time. One memory I have is when I was a kid, and I guess I was in high school. I remember I just got home from high school. I was driving. I pulled in my driveway and I had the guys on the bikes come and talk to me. They came and talked to me, and I remember them asking, do you feel like you're saved? And I'm raised Catholic and everything. Oh yeah, no doubt, 100%. You know, and I answered that question seriously thinking 100%, yeah, I'm good. And I kind of sent them on their way. Well, for some reason, that memory's always stuck with me. When I got here, I realized there was, with the teachings and everything, there was so much more to it. And kind of always thought back to that. Well, it's like, well, you know what? Maybe I wasn't 100% saved back then. Maybe I wasn't where I should be. Because I know I'm a lot better off now than I feel like I ever was. And I've really tried to even introduce that to my kids, bringing them here and talking to them about it at home and trying to, as easy as it sounds to pray at home out loud in front of the kids, a lot of times that's really difficult to do. It's like you mean to do it and then the opportunity passes and it's like, oh, I didn't do it. We didn't do it this time. We got to do that next time. And then they leave for 2 days and then they come back and it's like, cycle repeats. It's like, forgot again. How do I keep forgetting the most important thing? Every morning, not just to wake up and rush, but every morning I've tried to wake up and say a prayer. Like an out loud prayer while I'm still in my bed, before I even get out of the bed, trying to do that first. There's been mornings I forgot. So what I've done to combat the forgetting after the rush of the morning's done, when I get to work, the backyard at work faces the east. So there's a little, it's pretty private back there, and I'm the only one that goes there in the mornings. So there's a bench. I've set the bench out to where I can sit on that bench every morning and face the sunrise and say a prayer, like an out loud prayer, and get myself good with God for the morning before I go start work. I mean, when I got my divorce, it was just chaos. And you get kind of swept up in those things. And then I've had some personal things happen where it was kind of the same thing. You got swept up in it. And with the outside world, it's really easy to put God on the back burner, to put praying on the back burner, to put all of it on the back burner. You just got to be conscious of that and knowing that the world is driven to trip you up. It's not driven to bring you to God. It's driven to bring you away from God. And you've got to understand that, and you've got to, as much as you understand it, as much as you know that, you just can't give up. You're never gonna be perfect. You gotta understand that. And you just gotta push to be the best person that you can be. And you just gotta follow His example. It's more about self-control, of making yourself do the right things, because anybody can make you do the wrong things. You just gotta do the right things. Don't give up. Just don't lay down, keep pushing. And things will straighten out. All the storms end. Might be day 41, but they end. You gotta fight till the end, and you gotta fight the good fight.
I'm really grateful for Eric's testimony. One of the things I want you to know, we do not sync these videos up with what the messages are. So it's a very interesting thing that this one shoehorns right into what we're going to be talking about today. But before we get to that, let's worship.
I feel like you say that a lot.
I swear, it's the Holy Spirit. I just want to give the Holy Spirit the glory, you know. Great hymn of the church. I was thinking about Eric's bench where he said he sits in the morning and prays. And that's kind of what this song is. It says that morning by morning, new mercies I see. And I think what a great song to go with that. Let's sing. That mic up, please. Thank you. I want to hear you.
A summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon our sin and a peace that endureth.
song. What else we got, Regan? Okay. He's always been faithful. We'll be learning this one. This one is inspired by the other, right? So this is a newer song. We're going to learn it together. And it's inspired by Great Is Thy Faithfulness. So you're going to hear hints of that. I've never heard that. Have y'all heard that? Isn't that pretty? Wow. I love it. So good.
That was beautiful.
The recording actually starts with her singing a part of Great Is Thy Faithfulness.
Uh-huh.
That's why we did Great Is Thy Faithfulness.
Oh, it's beautiful. So pretty.
Who
Thank
sings
you for
that?
Sarah Groves,
if you want to Spotify it.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
All right.
The scripture today is out of James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. My brothers and sisters, whenever you face various trials, consider it all joy, because you know that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance complete its work, so that you may be complete and whole, lacking in nothing.
Amen. So, let me ask you, how many of you have ever been super anxious? Most of us, right? You ever had a moment where you just almost felt suffocated in that moment because it seemed like things were closing in? Amy's like, me too, Amy. I don't know what that looks like for each one of you, because it manifests typically differently in every person. And you know why? Because those spiritual forces that we renounce when we become members of the church or when we're baptized, those are real, and they know us. They know what makes us tick. They are clever. And so for each of us, anxiety is going to manifest differently, just like faith manifests differently. So we all have different gifts and services and all that's beautiful to use for the church, and that's great, and we want to do those good things. But there's a flip side to that. Also, there's forces that know our insecurities and our triggers and just the thing to get us all wound up and anxious, right? Let me tell you a little bit about mine. It usually starts with one thing, and then it's another, and then another, and then another. And then it's not just my drama, then it's somebody else's. And then it's another, and then there's a problem. And then I leave one situation and I go to another, and that situation becomes an issue and a problem. Because, get this, the dark forces know, Pastor. They know that if they can overwhelm me, and get me riled up and angry and upset about certain situations and thinking about too many things, that I won't get sleep, that I won't have joy, that I'll be problem solving because my mind is like that and it likes to stay busy. And so I'll be on a sea of despair, right? And it'll eat at me. And then I'll get tired. And then I'll get tired of them. All of those, right, who are involved, like up to here, right? And then I don't arrive in situations at my best. I don't know if I'm supposed to tell you all of these things about me, but that's how I work. That's how the dark forces in life work and ramp up my anxiety. If I think any of you are hurt, trust me, your pastor is bad to the bone when it comes to that. I will defend you to my death. So if I think any of you are hurting or being hurt, I'm going to defend you. And so that's another thing that will create anxiety for me. And if I think things have spiraled too far out of control, I may sometimes like say, hey, God, excuse me for a second. I got this, right? Any of you ever do this kind of stuff? I mean, I'm just asking if I'm preaching to the choir or if I'm just the odd man out, because I don't know. But that's how anxiety works for me. How does it work for you? What gets your bees in your bonnet? What gets you stirred up? And what creates that? What's your cycle? What do the forces know about you that really makes you anxious and get your anxiety skyrocketing? Come on, confess. I laid mine out there. Go ahead, Miss Cindy.
Okay. I'm a servant at heart.
Yep.
People know that, but I absolutely hate
it. Ooh. Yeah.
And when it gets out of control, I kind of do what we'll call the spin up.
Whoop.
And I can't get anything done.
Ah.
And my mouth, which runs all the time, goes into hyperdrive.
Okay.
And he just can't walk away from that.
Okay. You're a checklist person.
Yes, I have lists everywhere.
Okay.
If I can't find a list, I'll just make it.
Now, let me tell you about this type of person. This is the type of the person that will freak out if we run out of church bulletins, right? What? I'm not going to know what happens next. Take your church bulletin away, I guarantee it. Yes, ma'am. Yeah? Checklist. Okay. How many other checklist people we got in the room? Oh, look at them all. Look at the checklist. Nice, nice. Yeah. Kurt's right. Kurt's right. Say it again so they can hear. Check. Yeah. So, so Miranda's got a great question. That's a Kenan question. Does a checklist count if you put things you've already done on it just so you have things to check off? Yes. I say yes. And see, what happens is when I make that list, then she adds, then she writes my new checklist. She does love to write my list. No, listen, Cindy, it sounds like you kicked up a whole firestorm here. I mean, okay.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, the what?
Franklin Covey.
We have volumes of
years. Okay. Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Oh my God. He is organized to an extreme. Oh my gosh. See.
I have a... Get out.
Oh my God. These are the... These... Yeah. Organized chaos. Yeah. Okay. Ooh.
Yep.
D is like, amen. I'm gonna jump in on yours too. Yes. So, yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. That's good. That's good. How many, because I think that's important too, Matt, from the sense that, like, in a way, when we try to control things that aren't really controllable, it's kind of like setting ourselves up, which I think is the anxiety, right? Like, I know deep down inside I probably can't control this, but I'm going to try anyway. Just to know that I'm going to get my tail kicked, right? Right? And probably a couple of lessons out of it. So I feel you, bro.
Yeah, and sometimes even knowing this is outside my box,
yeah.
I have no control, but it still eats me up because it's not the way I want to be able to control. Mm-hmm. And I know I'm supposed to just let it go, but you can't.
Don't you sometimes also in that same vein want to like eat somebody else's lunch in that control thing? I want to control you too. What won't you do? Like, I mean, how many times I've gotten into miserable situations because I can't just let somebody have their own mess, right? So you try, and it may be with the best intentions of, oh, that's called Mr. Fix-It. Anybody a Mr. or Mrs. Fix-It? Okay, cool. You had something, Diane?
All the women.
We take God's job away from him. What a great way to frame that. Yeah. But by God, I am Mr. or Mrs. Independent, because we're taught that in this culture. Be independent, right? You don't need to be reliant on God or anybody else. If anybody's going to fix it, it's you. If you're going to do something right, you got to do it yourself, right? How many times did I hear that growing up? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Right.
I've come to learn. I've come to learn that in those situations with those specific things that are outside of my control, but I wish I could control it, I have found in just from time passing that every single one of those situations that I've come in contact with that I wish I could control, there is zero chance I would have resolved it better than he could.
Oh,
and every
true.
Single time,
amen,
every
bro.
Single time,
amen.
Like any amount of time passes, he does it the way it needs to be done. And if I would have been able to do it the way I could do it, it would have been amazing.
It's like the never-ending lesson.
No,
right?
Literally.
Amy, you had something. What were you going to say?
Well, I used to be more concerned with not being able to control things. I feel like I've gotten better on that. But to switch gears, overthinking.
Ooh.
And those thoughts come in. Mm. What is this person? What is this
me? Busy mind. Okay, me too. That drives me crazy. That's the kind of people always ask, what makes you lose sleep? That. Overthinking everything. Trying to solve.
They said this, but what do they really need? Do they really
need
that?
Yeah. What are the motives? What is really behind all that? Yeah. I wonder what happened.
That's especially hard as a single person, I will say. Especially with ADHD, it's extremely hard to navigate the dating world and without overthinking everything.
Does it get easier when you're married either? Exactly. And so for a teacher and a pastor, I think that's very similar. Like, because you do, you feel responsible for other people and their happiness and their health and their well-being and their spiritual well-being and all of that.
And
so
like
it doesn't
right
feel
now,
good.
They have me teaching or facilitating dual enrollment.
Yeah.
Which is a situation where like, so I'm not the teacher, I'm the facilitator at the high school for students who are taking a college class. And I have to make sure that every week they have everything turned in. And some of them are freshmen. And some like have, you know, 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th graders. And freshmen don't exactly understand it's a deadline for a college. They're not going to extend it because, you know, your car broke down or because you weren't here that day. That you have to turn it in no matter what. Like, she's not going to reopen it. She's not going to. They don't understand. And that makes my anxiety level. Like,
but it's also a decision they put in the hands of someone who can't even remember their lunchbox.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, seriously, right? Am I right? Like you know you're going to need your ID every single day. Why are you so challenged with this? He's over here complaining about the ID wearing. I love it. So, all right. So now let's just round robin real quick. Now just one or two words triggers. What triggers your anxiety? One or two words. Popcorn style. Fear. Okay. Good one. Yeah. Injustice for others. Hurricanes.
Adversity.
Mm-hmm. Conflict. Hurriedness. Who?
Loss.
Sin. Good. Could you, Regan? Yes, ma'am, Miss Claudia. Abuse. Mm-hmm. Overthinking. Sounds.
Tell me I can't do something.
Unneeded controversy. Yes.
I said, tell me I can't do something.
Oh. Rebellion. Like, don't tell me I can't, because I will prove to you I can, right? Yeah. Yeah. Sammy's like, me too. So. Like, don't tell me, I can't, I will.
That's motivation.
Sometimes.
Yes.
Yeah. So, shame, yeah. All of those are really good. Did you have one? Okay. Triggers for, what would you say that triggers your anxiety? Waking up in the morning? Oh, so tickling may be your trigger. You know, oh, your battery running out on your device, that would trigger anxiety for you, I'm sure. Yeah. You know what triggers my anxiety? Loudness. I don't like loud. I like... Oh! Oh, girl. Olivia, I loved you. I loved you.
That was well, quick.
Wow, just zinger.
Excuse me, girlfriend.
Okay. Yeah, so you're the opposite. Yeah, so silence is kind of a trigger.
Yeah. Our whole family is loud. Nobody is louder than you, darling. Nobody. You know when I say everybody go to their corners because mama needs some peace?
Well, I think daddy's about to say that right now. Everybody go to your corners because we need some peace. So apparently these illustrations have worked.
Triggered
anxiety. So now that we've ramped that up, let's deal with it.
Something was very interesting that you said, and a realization for me when you first started describing this is I have a physical reaction when I have anxiety. You know, my jaw gets clenched. Mm. You know, my shoulders are up high. I can realize when you're in tune with it, you know, that my breathing is shallow, you know, and so the opposite side of that is operating in it, like even praise and worship. Like I like a physical outward expression of worship, you know, so I can see how you were talking about the specifics and how the dark side knows your triggers and deals with you very, you know,
cleverly
and sneaky. It actually manifests just like I would praise the Lord in a physical way, you know.
Isn't that weird?
It is strange.
So interesting that worship and anxiety are being couched as really opposite things. Physical manifestations, both of them, but the opposite. Okay. And so now, how do we get from ramped up anxieties and triggers to the peace and the joy that God says we're supposed to have? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think you just said it. In worship, we can't help it. We have to let go and give it to God.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean, if we want out of that anxiety, that's really the number one answer is to let it, you know, we have to give it to him.
Yes.
My thought process is, you know,
we're talking about the anxiety. We're talking about where do you find the peace and the joy.
No.
Clearly
this is it. I find that when I make it a conscious effort to be eternally minded, being eternally minded is a really big deal, because when I go throughout my day-to-day life and, you know, something that offends me right now, I try to put it through the lens of like a 10-year perspective. Will that be an issue to me in 10 years?
Ooh, this is so good.
If the answer is no, then
That's helpful. I tell you why. Because so much of our life is lived like this.
Right.
It reminds me of that little ring guy on the Lord of the Rings. Precious. You know, like, right? It's just like, what's right in front of me? You know, like, we do our life this way, but if we would kick out and be like, does this really hold that much power in my life or whatever, then, gosh, that's great. Brilliant.
I'm gonna remember it in even 6 months.
Yeah.
knowing that Christ has defeated death and I will be with him forever.
Yeah.
When those two things are constant in mind, there's nothing you can do.
So what if we looked at our anxiety as kind of this distorted perspective and kind of an obsession? Precious, you know? And kicked it out, way out, trained ourselves to kick it way out. And that's what James talks about. Yeah. Prayer, how important it is to pray. But here's the issue with prayer. And I don't mean to like assume this is where you are with it. But look, I've been in ministry for 15 years and I've been a Christian most of my life. I want to say this. How many prayers I've prayed that I have talked the horns off a goat to God. Yappity, 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 God, 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 this, that, her, him, she, whatever, me, I can't do this, Lord, take it, Lord, do this, Lord, do that, Lord, could you please, why aren't you answering me here? Yackity, yak, 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 but how many times have I failed to shut up and let God speak and answer? Yes, sir. Yeah.
It says, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that in due time he may exalt you. Cast all your anxieties on him, for he cares about you. Be sober, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour, resisting him, affirming your faith, knowing that the same experience.
Good. It's really, really good.
And a practical application, like you were saying, when you're in worship and your focus is on Christ and you're feeling peace because you're completely focused on worship, you can do the same thing at home. The moment that I put worship music on and my focus is, the atmosphere changes. The atmosphere changes in your home. And us women are atmosphere changers, you know? So it's important for us to be focused on Christ and aligned with the Spirit and pursuing God so that that peace can come. It's just getting to that point of either the reminder that it's life is eternal with Christ, and so keep that at the forefront of your mind. But when you have anxiety, or you're focused on a subject, it's really hard to sometimes remember those things, harder to remember. Certainly having scripture around or those reminders written down for us people who like to have the notes and everything, that can work. But the worship music really changes things.
Atmosphere is definitely one thing. Another thing that I want to just kind of talk about that this church has specifically helped me with as a leader is community. Because here's the thing, here's the voice that lies, okay? You remember that dark force that knows all of our buttons to push and all that? So one of those buttons that I'm sure every single one of us can relate to is the I'm alone. I'm all alone in this. This is my problem. Nobody else feels this way. I am the only one who is suffering over this. If I try to talk about this with anybody, it's going to be trouble or bad or whatever. And see, a lot of times for me, that works under the guise of I can't ever divulge things because a lot of the things I deal with are confidential. But the truth is that there's a way that you can surround yourself by trustworthy people that is actually makes you realize that that's a lie. You're not alone. You're actually with others in a very supportive community surrounded by wisdom and all kinds of things. And who is better than a church who has a multi-generational congregation as smart and as wise as all you all are, to have to feel like they're ever alone. Like, that is a lie.
That isolation is a trap, for sure, of the enemy, because then those thoughts become really, really loud and you are able to focus on them. But talking about trustworthy people or people with wisdom, make sure when you're seeking counsel that those that you are with are speaking life over you.
Yeah.
You know, and that it aligns with the Word of God, that it's not something that is focusing on division, but speaking life over you.
Yeah. And so those are all really important things. You were going to say something, Miranda.
I was just going to, the Bible verse today is in James, and James is my favorite book of the Bible. But because of James 1:22, do not really read the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says.
Yeah.
Right? So I had a friend a long time ago quote the, you know, do not worry or be anxious about anything, mm-hmm. but through prayer and petition, present your requests to God.
Philippians 4,
which is
yeah.
Philippians 4.
4.
Mm-hmm. Is it 18? 8 or Philippians?
I don't remember.
Somewhere. But anyway, he said, you know, there's this. Do not worry about anything. Pray. But then there's James 1:22. Do what it says. Right? And it's like, oh, okay. But today I was looking while you were, since it was James 1, I was like, oh, I need to go read my favorites. And I decided to read the whole, all the way down to like 25. And I was on my phone, so I can't tell you what 25 says. But I've never read that far, like, on my own and just sat there and thought about it. But if you read the whole thing and then you get to 125, what it says is, you gotta get my phone back. Because I thought it was so, it was interesting because it went with today. So, but whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do.
Mm.
And so I feel like those words stand out, you know, like freedom and blessed, but, you know, whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom.
Wow, that's amazing. You know, when we were singing the song and the lyrics, we're talking about blessing and then 10,000 beside. God told me in that moment we were singing just a minute ago, underscore that. Like there's 10,000 blessings beside the ones that are there. So yes, sir.
I had a scripture that you told me one time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Genesis 1:1-4. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face.
Praise God. Wow.
And God said it was good because God does what? He uses all things.
All things
for good.
Together for good to those who love the Lord. Thank you for that.
Come on, and that's challenging because you just said a verse from James that's like, hey, believe that.
Right.
Do what it says.
So you mean to tell me that's true, brother? That changes things. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
All things.
Yeah.
Work together for, that's a very important
well, thing. And I think that's what this scripture is doing. It's helping us reframe the way we look at anxiety, right? I mean, we look at our anxiety as this awful thing that we should never have to experience, and poor me when I do, and oh my gosh, you know, please deliver me from my anxiety, instead of kind of thinking, what if my anxiety isn't such a bad thing? What if it's actually an instrument, a check engine light, right? That says, hey, maybe it's time to pray and connect to your community and get some support and some love around you in this moment, right? In your need. Did you have something?
When we talk about this, we all know God is faithful.
Mm-hmm.
But we're missing one word. It hasn't been mentioned, I don't think, and that's trust. We can come here with our sack full of our issues and our anxieties and our problems. And here in this place, we can lay it down and give it to God, and we feel relief. And yet, so many of us, when it's all over, we pick up our sack and
yes.
walk right back out the door.
Yeah, and drag it right back out the door.
And it's a lack of trust.
Yeah. Well, and maybe the greater trust that we're trying to learn here is exactly what you read from your scripture, right? And that is that we deal with this stuff by not only looking at it as a tool and looking at it as a signal for when we might need prayer, when we might need to hear from God or guidance from God and guidance from the wisdom of our community and stuff. But maybe, just maybe, we can take this and we can move forward in a positive way and actually believe that God will take everything and work it all for our good. So maybe our anxiety isn't as bad as we think it is. Maybe anxiety is a great way for us to understand what we really need. Maybe anxiety is a strength. Maybe it actually can help in a certain way. That's a great point. I mean, you know,
well, I should be 80 feet tall.
See, I tell my performers all the time when they get nervous about going on stage,
yeah,
that nervous energy, that anxiety, that's your body giving you the energy that you need to perform, and you need to harness it and channel it into your performance.
Mm-hmm.
You need to take that anxiety and change it into the feeling, the emotion that you're trying to portray to the audience.
What if God's telling us the same thing?
Hello?
What if God is saying, hey, why don't you take that anxiety and let's transform it to do something useful, something good, something that connects you to me closer, oh, thank you, love, and something that connects you to others. What if our anxiety is actually a way to go grow closer to God and each other? Yes, ma'am. Oh my God, you just did James 1 perfectly. You're a manifestation of James 1 and what it's teaching. I love that so much. I love that so much. Well, I think this has been a helpful discussion because I think it can help reframe anxiety for us a little bit. And I think the beautiful scripture that was lifted up across this room,
cool,
I love
that's
it.
That's how you're supposed to read the Bible, because you put all those things together.
Yes.
And it changes your perspective.
Absolutely, it does. There's no way to respond to that except worship, right? And that's going to help us. We've already decided worship is the opposite of anxiety. So let's do the opposite of anxiety together now.
By your side.
Why are you striving these days? Why are you trying to earn grace? Why are you crying? Let me lift up your face. Just don't turn away. Why are you looking for love? Why are you still searching as if I'm not enough? So where will you go, child? Tell me, where will you run? So where will you I'll be by your side whenever you fall in the dead of night, whenever you call. fall and please don't fight these hands that are holding you. My hands are holding you. Look at these hands at my side. They swallowed the grave on that night when I drank the world's sin so I could carry you. Give you life, I want to give you life, cause I'll be by your side wherever you fall in the dead of night, whenever you call and please don't fight, these hands that are holding you, my hands are holding here at my side, wherever you fall in the dead of night. And please don't fight these hands that are holding you. My hands are holding you. Cause I love you. I want you to know that I
go in peace. Amen.